Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal. Last week, we heard the music of Laurent Petitgirard. In fact, Eric Friedman was with us, and he played with the composer his violin sonata. Today, I am very pleased to continue this survey, this small little survey of the music of this French composer who in France is quite famous, and in America he is about to be. He has just returned from the Newport Festival, where the famous pianist Jean-Philippe Collard, played your what?
It's a two piano sonatas. In fact, it's my last piece. It's a two piano sonata called First Suite of the Meresson. And it's coming from an opera that I am writing, but you know, now to compose an opera takes such a long time. Mm-hmm. About, I would say, 10 years from the beginning of really working on it to the premiere. So that sometimes you need to have a few suites coming from, you know, instrumental suites coming from the musical material. So just to say where you are as a composer, you know, mm-hmm. and because sometimes doing the music, a few parts looks easier to transform in an orchestral suite.
You know? Yes. Laurent Petitgirard, my guest today. And so you extracted from the opera you're working on, a two-piano suite, which was just performed by you and Collard at the festival, correct?
Yes.
And the violin sonata we heard last week was also performed there by Friedman and yourself. And did you have a good time?
Oh, it's I must say, the first thing of all, that I spoke a lot of Eric last week, I would say now about Jean-Philippe, is that it's a dream for me when I suddenly is meeting with such an artist. And it means that Jean-Philippe Collard is not only a top-level pianist player, he's a musician, you know. He is music. He smells music. I mean, he is everything. And we had... maybe what I'm going to say is going to look a little bit rude, but I don't care so much about... I mean, I care a lot, but I don't care so much about the reaction of the public. That was very, very nice, but it's important to me. But the reaction of the musicians to my music, I mean, your reaction, the reaction of the people I would call my brothers, it's much more important. And the public has to understand that it has nothing to do like... not an idea like not respecting the public. Not at all. It's not my idea. It's just that we have some privileged brothers, and it's the other musician.
Yes, and of course, you know, there are many ways that only musicians understand each other. I don't mean to make it esoteric, but... that's the same with any professional group of people. Laurent, you're not only a composer. By no means do you live in an ivory tower. Last week we discussed the fact that you not only create film scores, you teach other composers how to make them. So you take that seriously, as Aaron Copland in America did and Virgil Thompson. You are a fine pianist. We're going to hear you in the last movement later on in the program of your piano quintet. We're going to hear a little bit from the music of the film Rosebud, which you composed. And we're going to begin with a work called Octet for Celli.
Yeah.
Tell me about this, Petitgirard.
I'm always been crazy with the celli. I think it's such an instrument. Mm. And it's really an instrument that speaks to me. The second thing is that eight celli together, it's like a human body alive. I mean, it's move. It's have something. It's like eight different lives, but being in one same body. I mean, it's so incredible, strong and powerful. And so I have written this piece for eight celli. Each celli is solist, but of course there is one which is really the main part. And it's a piece, it's a little bit special. And it's a piece that was written for a movie. And I must say that it's a French director called Bernard Cazan nothing to do with Elias Kazan, but it's Bernard Kazan. Mm-hmm. And this man is very involved with my music out of MovieScom, and he knows a lot about my classical works. And so he asked me many times to write a score for his movies and to write a kind of classical piece before the movie start even to be shoot.
You know? Yes.
And then all the actors, everybody listen to the music we recorded before, and then after I do a second score exactly fitting, you know, the each image. I mean, that I'm really following the movie, but with the original material. That's why what we are going to listen to now, it's a little bit special because, in fact, it's a tape that now I don't want people to hear anymore. It's about exactly my concert piece, except that in the beginning, there is two or three times, little things that sound a little bit like a Polish contemporary music from the 50s, you see? Mm-hmm. And that are really synchronized with the picture.
I see.
And it's just in the first 30 seconds of the piece that there is a few bears that doesn't belong to the spirit exactly of the whole piece.
I understand.
But the rest sound exactly, I mean, let's say that it's no more than 50 notes that change from the final score. And it's played by the opera, by the soloist of the opera orchestra in Paris, and the leader soloist is René Benedetti with first cello solo in the orchestra of the opera in Paris.
Laurent, let's hear it. Your octet for cello, the composer being my guest today, Laurent Petitgirard.
Thank you.
Oh, you have heard a magnificent work, Octet for Celli, the music of my guest today, Laurent Petitgirard, French composer who at this moment is in the United States performing, and we're hearing his music. After this message, we'll be back with more discussion about Petitgirard's career. This is David Dubal. Today my guest, the French composer Laurent Petitgirard. We just heard before that break your Octet for Cello. And let me tell you, this is a work that cannot help but move people. How did you come to compose a work of this kind of lyricism in an age so full of noise? And
well, maybe precisely because it's all my life. I tend to escape from this world of. I mean, I feel completely of my century, but sometimes you must protect yourself, you know. And
yes,
I think this piece is one of the pieces in which I recognize me the most. I mean, I definitely, if someone doesn't like it, and there is a lot of people, especially in the Boulez staff in France, would hate this music. If someone doesn't like this music, he doesn't like me. There is no hope, because I think there is no more representative music of, as well of my quality as my problems as a composer. Exactly.
It's Well, when you said that a certain group would not like your music, it's because your music in this day and age is only becoming again fashionable in the sense that one is allowed to feel the old kind of emotions, the emotions that we can readily understand, so it is not cerebral.
Oh yeah, no, you know, I agree, of course, with you. The second point is that I hear so many people always arguing about the fact that they are not so well known, and so I don't want at all one second that one could think that I'm, you know, this kind of person who is disappointed. I mean, I'm very happy, and I have, simply, you know, in France, I am played a lot by the interprets. It means that by the people who know my music and decide to play me. Mm-hmm. But for example, it's never happened to me in my country that a classical radio station invite me or just play 1 minute of my classical music. Mm-hmm. They play my movie score, but not my... Well, for a very simple reason, it's because now the whole France is under the domination of Boulez, and not specially Boulez as a man, because I just want to say that I respect very much the high quality level and the high brain of this man. The only problem for me is that sometimes he's too clever. I would like to be more sentimental and less clever. That's but that's my point of view. But the problem is that there is an enormous now privilege of the avant-garde in France, which means that even people like Dutilleux or Messiaen, who are so famous here, are not played in our country.
Even Boulez's teacher, Messiaen.
You must understand that hopefully now we will have the opera of Messiaen, which is something really important. And we are all, I think that the whole world of music in the entire world is expecting what is going to be this Saint-François d'Assise of Messiaen. We are all excited about that.
Yes.
Because it's really one of the composers who can make a large surprise.
But you were saying that you in France, your own music has not been on the classical station because of it is not.
Yeah, because the musical director of classical even belongs to all, you know, they have all the power.
Yet, in America, you have more chance of hearing a French composer, period, than anyone in France has a chance of hearing an American composer.
That's true too, you know, but I must say that it's a part of the beauty of your country. It's that you are a people, I mean, you are open and you are curious. This is very important. But to get over with that, my music is still played a lot in France for a simple reason, is that I make my own financement. It's make I make money, and sometimes a lot of money, with movie score, and I pay my theater, I pay my orchestra to have my music played. And that's, I mean, you know,
happens all the time, of course.
Yes, and I'm not so sad about that, and I think it's very important.
You, like many composers, are by no means embarrassed about your film score. You don't change your name or have a pseudonym, right?
Oh, no. I think that it's obvious that the language is different, that I would say the energy of the inside is not exactly the same because of the support of the picture, because of the language. You have to be, you have much more to take care not to, you know, to distract people from the story. I mean, you are just a part of an event. You are not the event.
Yes.
And the second thing is that, of course, you have to be more, a little bit more, I would not say universal, but I would say easier in your language.
Yes.
But I think that many main ideas are the same in the both. And I feel home when I listen to this music. I completely recognize myself, even 10 years after.
Yes, so that's what's important. Yeah. Yes. Laurent, you are a pianist, you're a conductor, you compose from opera to piano music. So you are a complete musician. And it's interesting that you also orchestrate, and we'll get to that soon, because we're going to be hearing you conduct an excerpt from La Vie Parisienne by Offenbach in your own orchestration. One of the important things that I have to ask you is, how do you tell composers who come to your course in Paris who want to make a fortune, let's say, as a movie composer, how do you get them to understand that this is a form to be taken seriously, and that maybe you won't make money, but you know you can do good work. You know what I mean? Some people will be a little commercial minded.
Yeah, there is many ways to do it. The first way is to show them that I'm still not a so rich man, and that I still know much more than they do. This is the first way. Uh-huh. Then you know, I have a certain way to teach, which is precisely not to teach. All what I'm trying to do, I think there is no composition teacher. Of course, for movie score, you have to know how to synchronize, how not to interfere with the dialogue, about the orchestration, many things, technical.
Yes.
And how you make a picture going slowly or faster, what mean exactly to be in a ternaire, in 3 bits, or binaire. It's all.
How
that
did you learn it? Because there's no courses in universities or music schools
that
I know of.
Because many people ask me, how did you do that? And one day I had to ask to myself, how did I, you know? And the second thing is that I was always very much involved and interested in what I was doing, you know, very careful. And so I had to make a tour in Algeria one day about concert, you know, and then because of the Algerian movie score composer have really problem, you know, they just start, there is a lot of things that they have to know. And many people have asked me about technical help. And then I have made a few conferences about movie scoring, you know, for a large audience. And from that came the idea, coming back in France, to really to do something to save. You know, it's just a question that this young composer doesn't spoil, as we all, everybody has a little bit spoiled. Not a whole movie, but one scene or two scenes in a movie sometimes when he was beginning. That's
sure.
Even later.
Of course. In America, there's a long line of important composers who have written music scores to movies, such as Copland, who won the Academy Award, you know, for The Heiress. And George Antheil wrote very good music for the film.
I must say that in the American composer, really my favorite is Bernard Herrmann. I mean, in the past composer. I mean, he's
an excellent movie composer, right?
And I was so sad that he died a few years ago, because it was really the man I wanted to see, and I feel really an acquaintance with.
And he conducted often too. Yes. So you had much in common, Bernard Herrmann.
You
and
have
yourself.
A lot, and when you see, he has his private music. You see that most of the most interesting movie score composer are composer who score movie.
Uh-huh.
I refuse anyone to call me a movie score composer. I am a composer
who writes
for movies.
Yes. Now, also, you're a pianist. For instance, let's say you were in your Paris apartment. Now you're leaving the studio and you're going home. Would you be practicing only your own music, or let's say, would you be doing a Brahms or another? You know, would you be practicing the older literature as well?
Well, I'm going to answer to you. I'm playing in exactly 2 weeks in France the Brahms 3 Intermezzo opus 117, and then the 4 Ballades opus 10, and then I'm playing the Children's Scene of Schumann, and I'm playing my Suite of the Mendelssohn, and which is only so 10 minutes of me in the program, and then I'm playing the devilish inspiration of Prokofiev.
Oh, that's not easy, is it?
No, it's really, that's the only problem now, because, you know, it's a music, and when you practice a music like that, really, the yatatatatatatampatam, it stays in your mind. That's why I have a very strong organization in my life. Morning is for me as a composer. You know, I wake up, I think if I can do all what I do, it's for one other reason. I need a very little hours to sleep. 4 or 5 hours, I'm fine. It's enough. So I wake up very early, and I have a wonderful, first I have my inspiration in morning. It's my son. I am lucky enough to have a 7-year-old son, which is, it's all my life. I was always saying that I could not be anything but a musician, and that music was the only thing in my life. Mm-hmm. Before anything.
Now you're a father and a musician.
Now I know that I am a father.
So you're a father, a pianist, a conductor, a composer, and I also know, although you're very slender, you're a great lover of food.
Oh, yes, this is very important.
Is there good food in the United States? Or is it only fair compared to what you know in Paris?
No, there is good food, because it would be, you know. It's just a The question is to know where you put the level. There is good food, there is even very good food. Mm-hmm. But when you come in a mystic of food, which is really what I am involved with, you have to be in France.
The mystique of food, then you have to be in France and perhaps in Paris. And that leads me to our next work, which you will be conducting, a very famous orchestra, the Concert de Colomb, The Life of the Parisian, La Vie Parisienne by Offenbach. Now, this is a ballet score, isn't it?
No, no. It's La Vie Parisienne. It's what
Offenbach
people say operette. I think it's awful. It's what Offenbach called it himself, an opéra bouffe. Opéra bouffe.
So you reorchestrated it, or what?
Yes. This was all, you know, a discussion I had. I had even with Antonio de Almeida, who I know is very famous here, and I must salute him for his work, because he wants the entire music of Offenbach published, and now we get it, and he has done an enormous job. But
yes,
there is still a few points in which we don't agree.
Mm-hmm.
And that I've seen for years and years and years people who say, we record the original version of Offenbach.
I see.
Okay. For example, Plasson with the Orchestra of Capitol, Toulouse with Virgin Crespin,
yes,
and the Madimes play, they have made the La Vie Parisienne, the
yes,
original Offenbach orchestration.
Yes.
Fine. This orchestra is a 100-musician orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
With, for example, 4 horns,
mm-hmm,
okay, 4 trumpets, 4 trumpets, okay, that's very good. Then, La Vie Parisienne was created in the Théâtre du Palais Royal in Paris.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the Théâtre du Palais Royal. I came. It didn't change for 200 years.
Mm-hmm.
I came, and I see that the place for the orchestra can accept 13 to 14 musicians.
I see.
So who is going to make me believe that there is an 80-musician or 100-musician score of original of Offenbach?
Yes.
He had no horn, or maybe one horn.
Yes.
And, you know, a very small formation. This is the first thing. The second thing is that it is nothing to do against Offenbach to say that even if he was the most gifted musician and he has a real idea about orchestration, he didn't know it so well.
Mm-hmm.
He has made, first, there was a few things that he was obliged to do.
Mm-hmm.
For example, he had very, his singers, except Horton Schneider or Zulma Buffa, it was all comedian.
Yes.
They didn't know anything about music.
Yes.
So all the melodic parts are doubled by an oboe or by a clarinet so that the guy can follow the melody. But you know as well as me that a voice of soprano singing with an oboe,
mm-hmm,
it's awful.
Yes.
So, I mean, it's not to spoil Offenbach to cut that. And, you know, the percussion, the brass and the percussion was always very heavy with major chords very in the deep.
I see, you know,
in the pop, 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 always like that with an enormous timpani. So my idea was this one, to take the original piano voice from Offenbach, which is in 5 acts and not 4 acts. To take this original score and then to see on the original score, there is just the indication of orchestration that he wanted. And from this indication from Offenbach, to reorchestrate it, not arrange, I hate this word, to reorchestrate,
mm-hmm,
as if it was Mozart music, with a whole respect.
I see.
And so that's why I feel more like a restoration Yes. As like an arranger, which is a word that I hate.
I understand that,
and this,
Laurent.
All this was an idea to love Offenbach and nothing else. And of course, all the versions, including electric instruments, drums, something like that, are so awful that it's not a question. I wanted Offenbach to be even more classical than he was.
And he really was, and he's not just raucous and vulgar. We're going to hear, by the way, just a small excerpt from your reorchestration of Offenbach.
It's a septuor, and with a leading voice by Daniel Schlosstower with a wonderful coloratura.
Fine. And I must say that this in our country is out on Peter's label, isn't it?
Yes, it's already my first record printed in the States.
Wonderful.
And the others are following soon.
So it's orchestrated by you, and you are conducting the Concert de Cologne, right?
Yes, it was the spectacle, I mean the show of the theater of the Châtelet in Paris, which is the biggest hall in Paris.
Aha. Let's hear you conduct it.
Donc je puis me fier à vous. Vous pouvez vous fier à nous. Les roules seront difficiles.
Les artistes seront à vivre.
Les artistes.
Les artistes seront à vivre, à vivre.
Les bêtises, les sottises, les potins et les caquets vont à bord de le grand monde, sont bien connus des valets. Ils observent ceux qui servent et le maître qui les a. Les égayent, ils les payent exactement pour cela. Les grimaces si cocasses, le bâtiment important. On admire et sourire, nous les ferons en riant.
Vous les ferez en riant,
nous les ferons en riant.
Nous les ferons en riant.
En un mot, ne craignez rien, si vous voulez des grands biens, on vous en fournira, servira, autant qu'il vous en faudra, on vous en montrera,
on vous en montrera,
autant qu'il en faudra.
Mes amis, mes bons amis, ah comme vous m'avez bien compris,
et nous vous avons bien compris.
Ah, nous allons vous manigancer un petit bal à tout casser.
Oh, what charming music. Yeah. Orchestrated by my guest, Laurent Petitgirard, we have heard an excerpt from La Vie Parisienne by Jacques Offenbach.
You know that I conducted it 40 times in the Theatre du Châtelet. So 40 times in 30 days. And well, left £20, which was very good. I should have to do it again.
You lost £20 in conducting it 40 times in 30 days. That's Well, you see, that is possibly a new bestseller, a diet plan.
Yes. Where it's very simple. Rather than don't eat anything more, just conduct La Vie Parisienne.
Oh, that's wonderful. Laura, we will be back with more discussion and some of your own music right after this message. My guest, the French composer Laurent Petitgirard, and we are talking about many things. He has a wide-ranging career, from teacher to composer to pianist, and a great lover of many things. You love the city of Paris, that I know.
Oh, yes, because there is such a softness in the air in Paris.
What about New York?
I'm fascinated by New York, as any artist can be.
What's the great difference?
Prussian.
The
maybe
what?
The pressure that is on yourself. Maybe because...
Oh, the pressure here?
Yes, the pressure. For me, maybe because if you don't live in a city, you don't know so well how to escape the pressure. That's, I'm sure that all the New Yorkers know exactly how to do it. For me, New York is a wonderful city as long as I have an enormous job to do in. Mm-hmm. And as I don't stay more than 2 weeks, then I have, you know, it's crazy. There's so many things I want to see, and you know, and I'm like a baby yesterday. I was seeing the Revenge of the Jedi. I was like, you know, I was so happy. And I'm interested by anything of arts and very curious. But there is, of course, I don't know why, maybe it's my European background. I need every stone around me to have a heavy history.
Mm-hmm.
And I miss that a little bit in New York.
You like to know that that stone is 1,307 years old and that Cardinal Richelieu walked past it in 1706.
That's exactly what's happened to me now in France. In fact, I am leaving now Paris. I'm going just to have a little studio there. And I'm living now in the south of France in a castle called Château de la Cour, which used to be the castle of Marie Stuart and castle of Duc de Guise and of the Rosicrucian. And it's a 12th century castle. And there is really, you know,
Be living in a castle. You'll be leaving Paris.
Yes. And I live there, and we have now a musical festival during 2 months and a half with all the elite of musicians, even from the United States coming, and we will have
what
really
do you mean
question.
Even from the United States? Oh, you mean as far away?
Because it's far away. I don't mean that there is no, you know, I would never say that.
I'm not a chauvinistic American, although I think America is beautiful.
Well, I think that first you are such open, and that when you do things, even mistake, you do it enormous.
Well,
that's wonderful, you know. I mean, when you want to have a beautiful orchestra, you have the best, you know.
Well, the United States is the grand manor now.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Laurent, we're going to hear you now as a pianist in your piano quintet. We don't have time for the whole work, but we do have time for the last movement. Tell me of this work, how it germinated, when it came. We know that you wrote your film music from Rosebud at 23 years old.
Yes, this was, let's say, 7 years ago. And it's very interesting to know that this piece happened to be, I mean, it was something strange. It's the same director who asked me for the octave of Celli.
Mm-hmm.
And this man he has seen the Preminger movie. And he called me, we have the same agent, and he asked my phone and called me and said, well, I'm very pleased to I love your score. I must say, I'm doing a movie that I've scored too, which was called Pocket Lover with Mimsy Farmer. And I am preparing this movie. I'm first finishing one movie now, and after I would like you for the other one. And then we discussed a little bit, and I said, what is the movie you are finishing now? He said, well, it's a movie that's going to be called Transfigurated Night, says it. And of course, I want to use Schoenberg music.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said, could I read the script? I mean, always interested. And I read the script, and I say to him, it's a mistake. I don't see why you take Schoenberg music. First, because Schoenberg music is done to be played in a concert. Has nothing to do with your movie.
Mm-hmm.
And even if it's very beautiful, it will never fit as someone that was something that would be really sync exactly for you. And then I say, yes, but I want Armando. And I told him, you know, I am writing now a quintet for strings, quartet, and piano, which is exactly this meaning of music. And I'm just starting to do it now, and I must tell you that your story is so strong. It was a story of very heavy relationship between a man and woman with a great love affair, but very dramatic. With the man was happened to kill his father, mm-hmm. which was really very strong. Mm-hmm. I told him, really, this moved me a lot, and it's even if you use this music, you have to know that my music is going to be influenced by your film. And he said, yes, but I don't want to, no question, I want Sean Mack. And from the day I started to write, every day was coming in my place. Could you show me what you have done today, you know? And, uh-huh. then, of course, as soon as it was over, it was played in concert, and he says, this is the music of my movie, which was called A Devil in the Heart. And, mm-hmm. and this was the score, but originally, and this is not the soundtrack of the movie yes. that we are going to release. This is really the piece for concert,
yes.
and it's so a quintet. It's played by the French quatuor français, French quatuor. It's the string quatuor from the opera, the yes. four solists from the opera.
And you at the piano.
I am the piano, and I must say, last little thing, that at this time I had a house in Montparnasse,
mm-hmm.
and those musicians are absolutely delicious. They came. Really for the pleasure to record that with me.
Mm-hmm.
And they came after the opera. They were very late. They arrived at around 1 o'clock in the night. And I had some smoked salmon and vodka. And we had a very large dinner, a little bit Russian. And then we recorded at 3 o'clock in the morning on my piano that I had, which was a half, you say demi-queue, we say in French. It's not a grand one, half grand playel.
Mm.
And with a high professional material that came specially to my house. But, you know, it's really a piece for the night, and it has been recorded, really, in the middle of the night in
yes.
Paris.
Well, we're going to set the mood now, 3 a.m, drenched in vodka.
yes.
After the opera, your house in Paris, you at the piano, drunk, playing the last movement of your piano quintet with the Quartet Français. Laurent Petitgirard's Piano Quintet. last movement of the piano quintet by Laurent Petitgirard. He was at the piano in the Quartet Français, the instrumentalists. I want to tell you what a moving work that is. I want very much to hear all of the quintet, and we will, because you are giving us, I believe, this recording for our library.
Of course.
Thank you so much, Laurent Petitgirard. Before we leave, and I want to say I'm very proud to be one of the first people to so to speak, champion your music in New York, I want to ask you what your plans are and what are the works you're working on now and so forth.
Well, now I am, just now I start to work on a violin concerto for chorus and orchestra.
Yes.
Chorus and orchestra, because I had always in mind this idea of a violin in the middle of a chorus.
Yes,
and
it's a wonderful idea.
I think it's something special.
And you're also working on your opera still?
I'm still working on my opera. I have to write a quartet for a competition. And then I have to write, of course, a few movies and TV scores and many piano programs that I have to handle, especially in chamber music. And then to have this large musical academy I have to take care of, and have all my young students that I have. I say young, but most of them are older than I am. And it's at the Normal School of Music in Paris. And I think, too, that I am at a special point of my life in which I need to take a little things a little back and to think a little more about many things in life.
So you'll be leaving Paris.
Yes,
so you'll be living in a castle.
Yes, I think this is very important, and I think that the most important support I will have in my music more and more is my son, and I'm absolutely positive and sure about that. And I know that because of him, I'm going to be a better composer.
Well, it's quite an interesting thought. I have never really thought of one becoming a better composer because of one son, but you see, that's love. So that's the ingredient that will make you a better composer, obviously.
Well, I'm sure that I must say that how I was proud and happy and I enjoyed to be here today with you. And I would tell you the same, friendly. I'm sure that when you will be a father too, you will make tremendous show.
Well,
which are already.
Laurent Petitgirard, I do not know if I will ever have children, although I have had two cats in my life, and they were very difficult. A Burmese and a Siamese. Now, again, I say thank you for coming, and it was a pleasure hearing your art. This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.